Hello and good afternoon. I would like to greet all the participants. It's indeed a great pleasure for the inter-municipal community of Alto Minho to take part in this event, Inclusive Maritime Education at Schools, European Experience. Of course, we would rather welcome you here in the city of Viana do Castelo, as originally planned. However, due to the current circumstances, that was not possible. The president or the political representative of our community was not able to join us on this event, but asked me to convey the following message. You are mostly welcome to our region, and hopefully very soon we'll be able to carry out a new initiative, a new project, in order to achieve the objectives of this program. And if the pandemic evolves, we'll hopefully be able to meet in person, which is always better than to meet virtually. This initiative was of utmost importance. This event promoted the sharing of experiences within the field of inclusive maritime education. So, if you allow me, first and foremost, I would like to thank the international partners that took part in this initiative: the IMO Sports Committee, the Cornwall Marine Network, the Moulin Mer Water Sports Centre, and the Clare County Council from Ireland. This was a great partnership, a successful partnership. The local stakeholders, both in Portugal and abroad, clearly appreciated the sharing of experiences, the initiatives developed, and the overall outcomes of this project, including the pedagogical tools. In our specific case, the school Cantiago de Mena participated in this project, the secondary school based in Viana do Castelo. And, of course, that I would like also to thank the remarkable, and I would like to underline, the remarkable engagement of the secondary school Carteado Mena. Their efforts were outstanding. I would like to thank both teachers and students for their commitment and engagement in this initiative. Without their support, without their engagement, this initiative wouldn't have been so impactful as it was. The main outcomes here in Alto Minho were the 4 transnational events, where the participants were able to link with each other, share their experiences, and learn from each other. We also developed 2 maritime educational videos for students and 2 guides for teachers. Then we had 2 teaching and training international activities. 26 students and teachers from our school took place in these two international events. We also developed three local initiatives, specifically regarding kayaking and surfing, and two regarding maritime education and raising awareness. 1,094 students took part in the different initiatives carried out over the period of this project, covering different subjects like surfing, kayaking, beaches, cleanups, maritime pollution, maritime trades, and so on and so forth. All these initiatives were extremely valuable for all. Within the scope of this project, we were able to buy adapted kayaks so that disabled students were able to enjoy this practice. And the final outcome is this end of the project conference, which, as I said earlier, was not able to take place in person. And we'll try to make the most of this virtual experience today. Finally, this experience for us was very, very valuable. I would like to thank all the partners once again, particularly to the teachers and students of all the schools involved. And I run the risk of repeating myself, but I truly believe that these projects make Europe stronger. This project promoted links between students and teachers across Europe. They were able to experience activities that would not have been possible outside the scope of this project. They were able to visit different territories, different cities, different schools. And down the road, if we make the assessment of this project, I'm pretty sure that these students will consider that this experience was extremely valuable for their life. This was a lifetime experience. This was the objective. And I think that we have met the objective. Now it's up to us to follow up on this work, and we challenge all partners to build up on the work done so far, of course, taking into consideration the future financing frameworks available. Again, this partnership, this program was key for our city, key for our community, but above all, it was extremely important for our school community. I didn't take part in all the events, but I was able to watch the videos and to collect the feedback from the students and teachers that participated in this project. This was a technical project, but above all, it was a project with a very human touch. Once again, we'd like to thank you for all your engagement and cooperation. You can count on us for any future initiatives. Thank you very much.
Merci beaucoup, Monsieur le Secrétaire Exécutif de.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Julio. The support of CIM in this project was very important for all the other partners, and I think we're all ready to start again with new projects to support the maritime education and development. So thank you once again. And we were waiting the intervention by Manuel Fernandes of the National Erasmus Agency, but he's having some technical problems. Francisco, maybe you can take on and specify. Francisco?
Unfortunately, no. I was experiencing some technical difficulties here. As I was saying, unfortunately, Mr. Manuel Fernandes is not able to join us this afternoon. He has some technical problems. He was not able to install the WebEx software, but he just sent us an email in Portuguese. And if you don't mind, I'll read out his email. And I'm quoting his email. Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to send you this note of appreciation for your work in this project, Atlantic Youth. I was available to take part in your event, but due to technical difficulties, I was not able to do it. Although I truly believe that in spite of the uncertainties that we are faced with due to the pandemic, that is impacting all the countries that take part in this initiative, we will use all means available to fulfill our mission. And our mission and your mission is to provide new opportunities for students of all European countries. I wish you all the best, and I thank you from the bottom of my heart. I would like also to acknowledge the work carried out by all teachers, but I would like to greet particularly our colleague, our French colleagues. Merci pour votre excellent projet.
Thank you for your great project.
Nous savons tous que nous allons en parler pendant la conférence, mais le
We are going to talk about the support of the Portuguese Erasmus agency that was fundamental for this project. So thank you, and we are going to propose new initiatives with all the partners that will have a wider scope. Maybe we can move on to the presentation of a report on Atlantic Youth activities over 3 years. So I will first of all introduce the subject, because today we are remembering a professor that was killed because he supported the freedom of expression. Of course, you know that this person was killed, as it involves the whole of Europe. So I would like to thank, on behalf of all partners, to thank the professors, the teachers of all our schools, because they are investing a lot to the heart of the Atlantic Youth Project. We can see they are involving, they are engaging every day for the mission, that is to teach to students that will be the future generation. Julio Pereira talked about this and the success of this project. So I thank all the teachers for that. And now we are moving to the presentation. Just a moment, please. This presentation is in French, but I know that interpreters received this document, and I'm sure they will translate what I'm saying. So the Atlantic Youth Project is a cooperation project developed in the period 2007-2020 for the innovation and a good practice exchange through a strategic partnership for school education to develop an inclusive maritime education in school and the accessibility for all students, all children, with an affordable, let's say, economic cost. We had secondary school classes from 12 to 15 years old students, with students having some problems and trouble, physical troubles or socialization problems, any type of trouble, problem. There are the Minho Lima in Portugal that was involved, Ayamonte in Spain, Landerneau d'Olef in France, with the Moulin-Mer Centre. And then we have the Cornwall, UK, and the Clare County from Ireland, with 6 partners and 7 secondary schools, with an Erasmus Plus support of €340,000. And then the action plan. First of all, we have annual yearly cycles of local activities in the 5 different sites. So 3 school years, we had some activity cycles at a local level. So local actions that allow to prepare the international elements we are going to mention. So we organized 3 events lasting 1 week. The first took place in 2018 in the county Clare. The second in France. And the third was planned for 2020, and it was turned into something different. So we decided to invest in equipment for young disabled students, and we organized some pedagogic tools and guides for students and teachers. And now we have this transnational conference in 2020 that is being held in October. So the expected impact, of course, is a motivation of different stakeholders for using the assets of maritime territories in the social and educational integration of young people, with an awareness raising on the maritime educative actions that contribute to inclusion, in particular as far as pupils with difficulties are concerned. A further impact is the awareness raising of population and stakeholders on maritime and oceanic challenges that involve us all, and the youngsters in particular, that will be the future adults. Awareness raising on the contribution of maritime environment to the education project. That also includes the implementation that follows the project on local policies. Then we have the opening of young people towards Europe and oceans and towards the values of solidarity and cooperation. And last but not least, involving teachers, engaging teachers for new projects in schools. And we know that on this last point, we have been quite successful. Partners, quite rapidly, we have our lead partners, CIM Alto Minho, We Atlantic, technical coordinator. Then we have the Clare County Department in Ireland, the Patronato de Ayamonte, so municipality of Ayamonte, the Centre de Moulin-Mer, which is the historic center, and the Cornwall Marine Network, a development maritime development agency in Cornwall, southeast of the UK. We have 7 schools that are listed on screen. We have the Escola Carta Domena, Viana do Castelo, Portugal, that is represented here. Escola Mir Anisiman, Clare County. Clare County again with the Scariff Community College. And then we have IES Guadiana Ayamonte, IES Gonzalez de Guia de Ayamonte. And then Landerneau with the College de Moscou and the Halton Community College in Cornwall. So they followed our activities with an active role within the Association of Youngsters for the inclusion of youngsters through different activities. One of this partner could not participate in our actions over the last year because of the COVID. And as far as local actions are concerned, this was a 3-year program on 5 sites, aiming at inclusion, at activities being affordable for schools, for the preparation of different transnational events. So all these points are interesting. We had 61 modules that were created and implemented in 5 countries with the support of local partners. Here we have some details, 8 modules on the living world of oceans. So whales, seabirds, aquariums, and some marine pollution modules. 3 modules on the coast, dynamics of coasts, biodiversity and conservation, tides and swamps, etc. 5 modules on maritime heritage, or visiting maritime museums, museum ship, and some work on the local heritage. 6 modules on maritime culture with theater plays and the creations for a maritime parade, and other activities. We also had 21 modules for the discovery of businesses and seafaring trades, fishing, shipbuilding and repair, passenger transport, seaweed, marinas, lifeboat stations, trades and apprentice sessions that were held on these topics.
So 15 nautical modules with swimming, sailing, kayaking, surfing, stand-up paddle, river descent, sailboat cruise, and also other modules such as participation in a competition for school projects on the maritime theme, first aid. And if the third years was a little bit difficult for the third cycle because of the health crisis, local actions were developed for the third years. And over 3 years, 854 students from 5 countries, so 854 different students who participated in the local actions of the project when our initial plan was targeting 783 students with 108 sessions. Now I would like to talk about the transnational event, which is the outcome of the work that was carried out in school on each of the 6 sites. These transnational events are a gathering for a week with over 100 students of the 5 countries who participated in the local actions of the country who meet around common activities as kind of a activity camp. And what we did over the two first years was possible in Clare County, where we had 108 students and some teachers. Then the second year we had 100 and some teachers and the students. And in October 2020, we had to innovate and find a solution because we did not want to cancel the event. So Erasmus allowed us to report our event into four local events that were coordinated and happened simultaneously in Ireland, Portugal, Spain and France. And there were 297 pupils and 37 teachers. So in total, over the three events, 514 pupils and 78 teachers and school educators participated, and our initial goal was 324 students, so we satisfied our objective. I would like to say that we had four videos. We had a video that was composed to create an initial interest with pupils at the beginning of a session that would speak about maritime questions in more detail. So the detail was to find out why we were going to learn about maritime subjects. It was an introduction that would explain this decision, this will of the school to talk about these questions. The second intellectual output was a video on maritime jobs organized by the Maritime Network to direct students to maritime trades. Aurélie will explain this thirdly. The third result was a guide for groups and experiencing difficulty at school, showing how the maritime education can lead to an inclusive education. This will be presented by Benoit later. And finally, the outcome is by the Huelva University and Alto Minho, which is a good practice guide for inclusion for teachers and educators and education stakeholders in towns and territories. Another action is that of equipment for pupils who are disabled, and we noticed that young people who experience disabilities or learning difficulties had difficulties in engaging with nautical activities. There were problems of safety with the stability of the boat, so we worked on a project with kayaks that were more stable with a better buoyancy to maintain stability and be reassuring for the user. Six kayaks were bought with three partners, and you see the models in the pictures here, and this increased participation, and these kayaks are currently being used on the water on three of our five sites. The implementation and the budget very rapidly. We put in place five local projects in Ayamonte, Cornwall, Alto Minho, Clare County and Castillo. We had representatives of the colleges and other participants who steered the project on a local level, and they were the speakers for the transnational project. We had a strong coordination that was indispensable with five meetings, physical meetings in person, and many video conferences. I believe it was 26 and now 14 during the COVID period, because video conference has proved to be an indispensable tool in the current situation. So thank you to our director and CIM Alto Minho. And if I look at the columns one at a time, for everything to do with coordination of the project with a budget of 340,000 euros, with the cost of travel, the intellectual productions, with a participation between all the partners who would come to assist, the partner project directors, 37,000 euros. And afterwards, we had a very important part of the budget dedicated to transnational meetings. So the first two meetings where the students traveled within the five countries, and 53,000 euros for the trip, 40,000 euros for accommodation, meals, for special needs support, adapted for the disabled. Sorry, I did not hear the number. And then, so a total of over 340,000 euros. So we can say that there was a strong dynamic within the five sites, the seven teams, with a positive commitment from the local teams and the local projects, and participation from the pupils and teachers was great and far beyond the objectives that we had fixed, with 800 pupils on local events and 514 pupils on international events. We will then produce a document that will recapitulate all the modules, and it will be available to everybody. We were able to produce our intellectual outcomes, and you will be able to see that they are quality outcomes. There was a strong collaboration, of course, with the school meetings, and all the two first and the third events also had a very rich content, with a video conference between pupils and teachers of the six countries, of strong cooperation between the schools in the five countries. And the great satisfaction for us was the importance of the conclusion theme, a thematic that is very important, because we know that many children give up or are isolated and marginalized from the educational program, and that is a concern for teachers who want these pupils to remain within education and within the project. And this theme was very strong, and it became stronger with the development of the project. It is an opening to the world, an opening to oceans on the practice of outdoor activities. This success confirms that it is essential, as it was done during the project, to place the schools at the center of the project, and that they take ownership of these projects, of these literacy projects at school. There is a common goal from partners and schools to go further than Atlantic youth, and to go on to a project on the Blue Atlantic schools, les écoles Blue Atlantique. And finally, there is the certitude of having brought many pupils closer to the ocean that surrounds them, to have awakened their minds on the stakes at play, on the future of the oceans. And we gave them a feeling to have participated in inclusion educational projects within Europe and the Atlantic region. Merci, obrigado, gracias, thank you. And I have now inserted all the logos of the partners on the screen. Thank you. So, I don't know if anyone can hear me. Hello? Do you hear me? Yes, we hear you, François. I'm having a little technical issue. I think I'm going to manage. So now, unless there are any questions or interventions on what has been said, we have a little time available. So we may answer a few questions or interventions if you have them. Thank you for your question. I hope it wasn't too long. Now we're going to go to the second part of this conference, which is the presentation of the intellectual outputs by partners. First of all, I would like to give the floor to Daniel Medina, professor at the Huelva University near Ayamonte, who worked with the CIM on the intellectual production.
Thank you very much. We have shared, we're going to share a video for this presentation that we prepared. So just give me a minute. Good morning. First of all, I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to participate in this third transnational meeting in Viana do Castelo, which will be held virtually due to the problems that we have today because of the pandemics of the COVID-19. Today, we're going to present the Guide to Good Practice in Maritime and Nautical Education in Schools. The people responsible for this guide are the professor of the University of Huelva, Eduardo Fernandez Oscorta, another one, and me, Daniel Medina Rebollo. We are professors at the Center for University Studies here. There are authors who propose the need for physical activities in the natural environment to form part of the content of the physical education curriculum due to the amount of benefits and values that are worked on. Water sports or maritime nautical sports can be a stimulating content to teach within primary and secondary education due to the originality, since it is not very present generally, and they can be generated to the students by the practice of physical activity, and it's got very good benefits that can be developed in an educational physical and level. Authors such as Thompson, Body, Stein, Ware, Barton, and Diplett indicate that there are many more teachers that are included AFMN content within their teaching programs or curriculums. But these are not materializing in the end. The reasons are that there's a lack of time, a flexibility in order to carry out these activities, the distance between the spaces to practice this, or they need to have materials. Also, there are other factors such as the involvement of the teachers or their lack of training or aspects that are related to other things. This good practice guide of maritime education in school is in collaboration with the sports municipality department of Ayamonte. And we are doing inclusive activities in order to develop skills and general competencies for children that are living in coastal areas in cities that are in the coast, in order to carry out actions that are related to maritime and nautical world. The Atlantic Youth Project belongs to the European Union's Erasmus Plus program for the education, training, and training of youth people, young people. In this project, apart from the municipal sports department of Ayamonte, we have all the departments from Alto Minho in Portugal, also the Clare County Council of Ireland, Cornwall Marine Network Limited of Falmouth in the UK, and the certain center of Moulin de Mer in France. So there are five countries in this project: Portugal, Spain, France, the UK, and Ireland. And they are in each place, we have a local project team that will be composed by the representatives of the schools, public authorities, structures, etc. Also, each year we will have a transnational meeting of those courses that were involved in the project, or the classes that were involved in the project, and that is going to take place for 5 days. And this will give us the opportunity to develop the general and maritime knowledge in the framework of an educational week, and it will bring together the young people and the teachers. The number of students who will benefit from the actions of this program will be, over the 3 years will be 783, for a total of 135 professionals. This good practice guide developed the following aims: to know the benefits that bring the realization of activities, to identify the rules that are necessary to take into account and carry out these activities, and also describe the objectives and contents to be developed in this type of program, elaborate guidelines in order to know how to teach these activities, and also guidelines to or evaluation criteria. In order to develop a complete and useful proposal, we have carried out different actions, which we will now present in a systematic review. Then we evaluated Atlantic Youth Project, and then finally we carried out interviews with most of the relevant agents of this project. As we said before, we carried out a systematic review of the programs related to maritime and nautical education in primary and secondary education in Spain over the last 10 years. From this analysis, information has been obtained concerning the objectives, contents, methodology, and evaluation. Then the assessments of the Atlantic Youth Project were analysed through the records of service accumulated throughout the local actions that have been carried out each year, as well as the transnational meetings where students and teachers from Spain, France, England, Ireland, and Portugal have participated. Last, with all these previous actions, individual structures were designed for most of the relevant agents of this project. These are the organizers, the facilitators, etc. These interviews were carried out in the transnational meeting in Moulin de Mer, France, from the 26th of May to June. Once they were carried out, they were analyzed, and they were included by the research group to extract and develop the key points of the development guide. The aim of this study It was the design and creation of the guide, and to contribute to the approach of physical action or activities. And the final aim is to create this guide of good practices of maritime and nautical education in the school environment. This is in Spanish, English, French, and Portuguese, and this will facilitate the implementation of these activities because of these translations. The most important contribution to the development of this guide was the information that came from the analysis of the interviews of the agents who participated in the elaboration of the guide. It should be noted that a total of 364 contributions were obtained from the interviews with the organizers, facilitators, and teachers. This guide develops the most relevant aspects of the analysis process. This have been the benefits of nautical activities, legislative aspects, objectives to be achieved by this type of programs, the contents to be developed, methodological guidelines, and aspects related to evaluation. we should emphasize the methodology aspects during the process that we had when we carry out activity, nautical activities and the security of the participant sections that we will develop in the future. It is recommended to carry out research activities which should be done through games. The more theoretical content will be done in the first part and the rest we will do in the other times. In order to provide a quality session, it is recommended that groups have between 8 and 12 participants. So once we do one session of nautical activities, we are going to find several challenges: the distribution of materials, the entrance of water, the pace of the session, the environmental conditions, and the full group support. Safety is a very important issue when doing a water sport. The mandatory material to do an activity or water sport must be the life jacket, of course, or life vest, which must be adjusted to the characteristics of the participant. Also, it is very advisable to use neoprene suits, which will prevent situations of hypothermia and cuts or scratches during the activity. Last, depending on the characteristics of each sport, it is advisable to use helmets, gloves, water shoes, or boots. As for the facilitators and or instructors, they must be trained in first aid so that in case of an accident, they can act correctly. Also, for any activity, there must be a minimum of 2 facilitators in case of an accident. One can help the victim and the other one can look after the group. In addition, to correctly perform any water activity, it's essential that participants know how to swim, of course, to avoid panic situations when falling into the water. With the after carrying out this guide of good practices, we want to facilitate the development of didactic proposals in the area of physical education. However, during the development of this guide, we have found that there is very little evidence regarding maritime education programs. We think that this is because they are being carried out outside of the school curriculum. Likewise, a greater coordination of public and private entities is proposed for the development of activities. And I would like to end this presentation with a Chinese proverb that we have included in the section, in one of the sections of our guide, that says, "Tell me and I will forget, show me and I will remember, invoke me and I will understand." Thank you very much for your attention. I hope that this guide of good practices of maritime education, nautical education in the school has been interesting for you and can help you in the future to carry out such activities with your students. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Daniel. I think that the guide is already translated into French and that it is a very interesting document that was supported and that is a complete guide with a pedagogic, with an educational side that is very interesting. Then let's move on with the next intellectual output. The Cornwall Marine Network, Aurélie Nollet, is going to take the floor. If possible, Aurélie, s'il te plaît, please, can you open your screen so that we can see you?
I'm Aurélie Nollet. I'm the director of the Cornwall Marine Academy and Cornwall Apprenticeship Agency at Cornwall Marine Network. We are a not-for-profit organization representing and supporting 400 marine businesses in Cornwall. So for those who don't know where Cornwall is, so there's a little map on the presentation that I'm sharing, and we are at the very bottom of the UK. Pretty much opposite Brest, so we wave at colleagues in France.
Aurélie, est-ce qu'il est possible de mettre en plein écran?
I think it is. Is it not? Is it now? Is it, François? Is it working fine?
Oui, c'est bon, c'est bon. Merci, merci.
No problem. Thank you. So it has been our pleasure to be a partner in this Erasmus project over the past 3 years. And our role specifically in this project has been to develop resources to promote maritime careers, in addition to running a program of local activities, specifically marine activities, for young people, students from Cornwall, and in addition to sending them as well to France and Ireland to join students from other countries and take part in marine activities. Just before I go into details about what we've developed through this project, I thought it might be worth taking a step back and just reflect on why we need to promote marine careers. So I'm moving on to the next slide. At the transnational level, the marine sector is a key economic sector for the EU. I've taken some figures from the 2020 EU Action Plan for the Atlantic Area, which stresses the central role of the blue economy, which generates 73.4 billion euros of gross value added and employs 1.29 million people. It's also worth noting that the Atlantic Area is the largest EU sea basin and represents 36% of the EU blue economy gross value added. So the 2020 EU Action Plan for the Atlantic Area identifies a number of key priorities for the sector for the next 7 years, all with a sustainability objective. So these areas of future growth include the promotion of sustainable coastal tourism, the transition to offshore renewables, green shipping and innovative port activities, as well as sustainable management of marine space and the fight against plastic pollution. All these priorities represent a high job creation potential within those coastal communities, including the coastal communities that are represented within this Erasmus partnership. If we look very quickly at the context in the UK, the marine sector is one of Britain's biggest industries. 95% of the UK global trade happens by sea. The sector also represents just under 1 million jobs and contributes around £40 billion to the UK GDP. So Maritime UK, of which we are a member, is the collective voice for the UK maritime industries, and they champion and work to enable a thriving marine sector. They've recognized the importance of promoting marine careers at national level and are coordinating efforts from organizations across the country to promote marine jobs to our young people. Now, if we look at a smaller scale as well, and the marine sector in Cornwall, the marine sector represents about 15,000 jobs, and that represents 1.12 billion of GDP per annum to the Cornwall economy. So, being said differently, that's one in 15 people in Cornwall who work in the marine sector across 855 marine businesses, all dotted around our coasts and located mainly in six geographical clusters. So all of that shows that the marine sector is pretty key at EU level, at national level, at local level. However, there are a number of challenges that the sector faces. This includes skills gaps in the context of an aging workforce. A lot of the workforce in the marine sector is getting to the age where they will retire, and we need young people to come in to join the sector. There are also emerging technologies and industries. That means new skill sets are required, and we need the right training programs to be developed to be able to address that. Another issue that is faced by the marine sector is the limited knowledge of the variety of jobs available. If you ask young people what the marine sector is about, quite a few will say, oh, it's about boat building, it's about marine engineering, it's about fishing. And after those three examples, they will quite often struggle to say what else the sector encompasses. The marine sector is actually one of the broadest industries and sectors with a wide range of jobs available offshore but also onshore. Linked to the limited knowledge of the variety of jobs, we've got another issue, which is therefore the limited attractiveness of the sector for young people, which is why organizations like us, like all the partners in Atlantic Youth, have been developing a number of actions to try and improve the awareness of young people for the sector. Here in Cornwall, we have been using employers as the solution to improve young people's awareness of the sector and also increase improve their employability. Over the years, we have developed a network of 105 marine businesses acting as ambassadors, as volunteers, and giving their time to talk about their job, talking about organizing site visits, organizing work placements, job trials, apprenticeships. Over the years, in 12 years that we've been in operation, we've delivered career advice to 35,000 young people and vocational training to 3,500 young people. We've also taken part in a number of transnational projects as we recognize the importance of being connected to other regions to share initiatives, but also taking into account the fact that the marine sector is a transnational sector with an international workforce, and we need to prepare our young people for that international working environment. So our role in Atlantic Youth specifically has been to involve young people in developing a video that would promote marine careers across the Atlantic area. So to do that, we got students from the five countries to prepare questions that they would like to ask to marine employers. They came up with questions like, what jobs are there in a marina? What do you like about your job? What do you do on a day-to-day basis? What is the role of a harbor authority? When was the last time you went on the water, taking into account the fact that not all marine jobs are based offshore? What skills are you looking for? Taking again into account the fact that a lot of the skills actually are transferable skills, and you can use skills from one industry to another. And what are the career opportunities available in marine conservation? So we collected all the questions that the students from the five countries had, and we then selected a number of employers to answer these questions and to interview them. We paid attention to a few things when selecting those employers. We wanted a mix of female and male role models, especially as the marine sector is quite male dominated. It was important for us to showcase the role of women as well in the marine sector. We also interviewed employees and volunteers. Not all young people will work in the marine sector, but those living by the seaside may like to volunteer for beach cleaning or as lifeguards, etc. So it was important for us to showcase those other opportunities that benefit the communities. We also selected employers who were based onshore or offshore for their day-to-day job. And we also paid attention to illustrating the variety of jobs in the marine sector and also showcase marine conservation jobs, marine leisure jobs, as well as boat building, marine engineering, or jobs in the defense sector, for example. So as a result of that, we developed a video that I won't play today, but I invite you to have a look at our YouTube channel. So as part of this project, we have developed an Atlantic Youth Maritime Education YouTube channel. You can see the address here at the bottom. We had all the partners contributing to that channel, and you can find videos in English, Spanish, Portuguese, and French. And all those videos focus on different jobs. You have some videos about being a boat builder, some about being a marine electrician. So it's a great source of information for those young people in the Atlantic area. In addition to that, I also wanted to mention the job, the work that the team has been doing here over the lockdown period. We developed another YouTube channel called the Cool Marine Academy Stay at Home YouTube channel that we used during lockdown to promote marine careers and marine activities to young people. You've got a number of interactive activities there that you could do at home and don't require too much equipment. And that has been a big success during lockdown. You can find about 160 videos on this platform. In addition to that, through Atlantic Youth and in general through our activities to promote marine curious young people, we've developed a number of resources, including games and quizzes, job cards, employability resources, all of those we use on a day-to-day basis when we talk to young people about marine curious. So as a conclusion, I just want to say, to focus on three key points. The fact that the marine sector offers great career opportunities locally, that's what all of the partners have tried to demonstrate to young people over the past 3 years. We all are located in coastal communities, which rely quite heavily on tourism being affected quite a lot with the current pandemic. So we really wanted to see that actually beyond tourism, there are a lot of jobs available in these career communities. And actually the marine sector on average offers salaries that are higher than the average across other sectors. At least that's the conclusion that we've made here in Cornwall. My second point is that transnational cooperation is key, with 95% of the trade in the UK taking place via the sea. It's pretty key that we've got connections with all those countries, and that we train our workforce to be able to interact with an international workforce and make the most of these international connections. The last point is about marine careers promotion, the fact that it needs to start from a young age. Young people tend to make career choices early. We need to make sure that we don't start promoting marine careers at the age of 16 or 17 as an option. It needs to start much earlier than that. And that links to the presentation that we've just had about how we make that happen and how we embed maritime education in school curriculums and embed marine leisure activities, all type of marine activities in school education. Thank you, everyone.
Merci, Aurélie. Merci pour...
Thank you, Aurélie. Thank you to Ayo Monte. Thank you to Cornwall Marine Network for their contribution to the project, particularly on the employment and career option. It's important to show young people that the stakes are environmental ones for the oceans, but there are also sustainable work opportunities, and these professions are sought after, and there is work in the marine sector, and that will be increasing in the years to come. So thank you. And now we will talk about the fourth outcome, the CIM Alto Minho. So I now give the floor to Paola Cordona and Francisco Mendoza.
Good afternoon, everyone. I would like to greet everyone and thank Celia Marques and Alinda. They were the technical supporters for this. The video that you'll see, the production of the video as an output, aimed at conveying an overview of the maritime world and maritime challenges. And it targeted students between 11 and 15. The challenge of the production required some reflection on part of the teachers, namely, but also the City Hall of Viena do Castelo and the Documentation Center, the Maritime Documentation Center, with all of the partners also connected to research. The video is called Sea Challenge and addresses issues that have to do with maritime resources, environmental activities, but also research and activities connected to shipbuilding, fishing, and maritime culture, climate change, pollution, the preservation of the environment. And as a base message, an awareness campaign regarding sea challenges. The footage was taken from in 2019 and was Aldo Norte, also based in Vienna Castell, responsible for that. And I will see if I can share the video with you. Here it goes.
I remember the first time I felt the ocean breeze in my face, how the wind unraveled and entangled my hair. I remember the first time I smelled the salty scent, how my lungs and my body opened up to the immense blue cloak waving in front of me. I'm lucky enough to live on the coast. Every day I can see the ocean, I can smell it, I can feel it wetting my feet. I love walking along the beach while looking at the skyline where I can see the boats fishing or sailing. I also enjoy building sandcastles, playing around the rocks searching for shells, and swimming in the waves. One day I even tried surfing. How cool is that? Covering 70% of the Earth's surface, the ocean is the place from where all life forms evolved initially in our planet. From microorganisms to amphibians, reptiles, birds, and mammals, can you imagine? Throughout history, humans have been mastering the art of shipbuilding and sailing across the planet. Since immemorial times, either to trade commerce, to fish, or to discover unknown territories, sailors ventured out into high seas and have been bringing us food, large quantities of goods, and knowledge about other people and cultures. Nowadays, even with all the human technology and knowledge, the sea is still a mysterious place. Only 10% of sea life is documented, but we already know more than 230,000 marine species. We can say the ocean is the biggest house in the earth, sheltering plants, sponges, corals, shoals of fish, dolphins and whales, turtles, penguins, and tons of birds. The deep waters are home to wildlife and some of the biggest creatures on the planet. We are used to looking at trees as the planet's main providers of fresh air, and whereas their relevance is undeniable, actually the ocean is the one responsible for producing 70% of the oxygen we breathe. There are tiny microscopic plants all over the ocean that act in the same way as tree leaves, by absorbing carbon dioxide and releasing oxygen. As we do not see them, we tend to forget about them, but they are one of the most important beings on the planet, keeping us alive. Ocean also provides us with seaweeds and minerals to produce medicines and cure diseases. Scientists extract chemicals from corals and sponges in order to make antibiotics and antiviral drugs, and they are trying to produce new cancer treatments made out of marine plants. On the surface, humans are using the sea to produce energy carried by ocean waves, tides, and marine current. Some countries also install offshore wind turbines to generate electricity. So, the sea represents energy, power, beauty, vitality, and life. However, the exploration of the ocean must be careful and respect its sustainability. Over the past decades, the excessive activity of many companies has been contaminating the ocean waters with chemicals, and Western countries' lifestyle has been generating more and more garbage, throwing into the ocean an insane amount of plastic. We've been dangerously harming the delicate balance of the ocean's ecosystem. We consume too much. We produce too much garbage. Plastics and chemicals end up in the ocean. It is in our hands to do better. The existence and welfare of the sea are vital, not only for all the species living there, as also for you and for me, for our families and friends, for our neighbors, and for all the humankind. Regardless of how close or far you actually live from the coast, your life is affected by the marine ecosystem. The sea regulates our climate, provides us with food, transportation, jobs, and it's also a place where you can have fun and enjoy a summer day.
Merci, Paola.
Thank you, Paola, for this very beautiful intellectual outcome. Paola, would you like to conclude?
Just a word about the future, about renewal of projects with this reach and this scope. And another aspect that has been essential for CIM Alto Minho, which is the ability of inclusion, to address inclusion in all of the projects that we have been undertaking. And that principle of inclusion should cover, of course, all of the community and not be limited to school community. We hope that it can beyond those borders and reach all of the entire community.
Oui. Merci, Paola.
Paola, and thank you to the team of CIM Alto Minho. You mentioned Cecilia Marquez and Aline Chaubis that also worked on this beautiful video. The quality is fantastic, and I'm sure we will be able to use this video in many schools to explain to young people how the ocean is important for the species, for oxygen, for food, for energy, etc. And honestly, I would like to congratulate those who produced this video. Now I think we will look at the last intellectual outcome, which is that of the Center of Moulin-Mer, a guide for marine education that is inclusive in schools. Hello, hello again, do you hear me? Yes, very well. We hear you very well. I will attempt to share this document. So we will present the intellectual outcome that was made by the Center of Moulin-Mer in collaboration with the College of Mesquat, with Patrick Kerbrat, the head of the college and the SEGPA section. We also worked with the Ministry for Education, with Christian Pasquier, regional advisor for the national education. This guide has the ambition of being a practical for teachers in Europe, and it is about the sea world working for school inclusions. We call it the Sea Project for pupils in difficulty in education. It is the product of reflection and practical animation that allow any teacher to consider a curriculum for students in difficulty. So the project, the Atlantic Youth Project, I do apologize. So the Atlantic Huge project looks at the marine education for inclusion. What is marine education? So the world of the sea, how can we summarize that? It's the concrete teaching of all the links that unite man to the environment and to the oceans and the coast. So they need to know the coastal ecosystems, marine ecosystems, the story of evolution, of human activities at sea, fishing, aquaculture, industry, sport, nautical, energies, transport. It includes art, literature, paintings, culture, land art, music, photography. It is also the discovery of trades linked to sea, fishing, metalwork, sea shells, naval construction, science. It is also understanding the impact of human activity on the environment, and that will be at the heart of this guide. How can marine education become an inclusion factor at school? It allows teachers and pupils to apprehend all subjects using a link to the sea. We want to help the pupil to become the actor of his learning through navigation, visits, experiences, production. We want to encourage meetings with maritime professionals. We want to overcome one's limits. We want to work on self-esteem through activities and talks. We want to respect the group, and we want to experience solidarity, and these values will be reflected in the experiences that we are about to present. We also have a passage regarding inclusion at school, a passage produced by Mr. Pasquier, who is a pedagogical advisor for the education ministry in France. It's very interesting on the approach of inclusion at school. So the idea is that pedagogical projects must reference inclusion. The inclusive logic says that stakeholders, pupils and parents have to be a part of the educative process. So there is this well-known image of what inclusion represents with other themes, for example, exclusion, segregation, or integration. I'm talk about this past because Mr. Cabrac will explain the SEGPA, general teaching, recognizes that the role of the teacher is very important. The teacher is a coach, an animator, an educator, a motivator, and an evaluator. And that is something that we will find in all the projects that we present throughout this guide. So now this is the detailed program of the choices that were made by the teaching team of SEGPA for the pupils in difficulty at the Mesquer College. Mr. Cabrat will talk about that later. Here we focus on what affects the centre of Moulin-Mer, because it is the first centre of activity classes at sea created in 1962. And we see Jacques Carroise that invented this. So Moulin-Mer is almost 60 years old and has inspired other structures in France. So activity centres at sea that are well represented in the Brittany region. What's the concept of sea activity classes? They are educational activities where the pupils and teachers travel, and there are two main axes: educational activities linked to the environment, political activities. These are the main values that created the concept of the sea activity class. So what are the advantages of a sea activity class? First of all, centres that are quality environment. Then we have a windsurfing school dedicated to the discovery of nautism. So children stay on site and have access to the centre. So it's an integrated approach. We also have professionals, qualified professionals for sport and the environment. There is also an educational target and a target of progress in the activities. We must see an evolution of the pupil during the camp. A teaching team will achieve the program together. We help the teacher to create their program, and the stay is a central element in the school year. So we work on the project before, during, and after the camp. And this is why the camp can be exploited after the event. And so we fight the pedagogical objectives with proposals that we see often in France with sea camps. We see the adaptation of activities to the national curriculum, and then we practice complementary activities, and here are a few examples: initiation to nautical activities, observation of the coastal fauna and flora, tide study, meteorology, study of the marine heritage, discovery of the sea trades, reading the landscape. So the sea camp, how is it inclusive to citizenship? The sea camp is a shared period of time. Everyone is housed together at the centre. The sea camp brings codes and representations in the relationship between pupil and teacher. Everyone is put on an equal footing. Learn the rules of life in collectivity by day and by night. We learn to respect the other in his difference and to show solidarity on earth as on sea. Brittany Strew, because of the creation of Moulin Mer in 1962, Brittany became the land of sea camps, because that is where you find the most centers of sea camps in France. And for Finistère, for the department where we are, there are 14 centres of sea camps, and 12,000 pupils come every year. The Brittany region hosts 25 permanent centres, and here is a link where you can find all the sea camps in Brittany. So the region was really an expert on the inclusive approach for sea camps. To conclude, I will remind you the rules and the extracurricular activities that are very important for the development of children. And Mr. Pascual says that we have to act within a shared regulatory framework that includes the action context that favour experimentation and pupil and teacher engagement.
This project involved Brest University students who were very interested in this topic on the development of sea classes at European level. This work was carried out during the second international meeting that underlined the interest in sea classes being developed at a European level. This is what we can say on the production, the output that will be translated into English. Thank you for your kind attention. Thank you. Thank you, Alban. This output will be very useful. It was drawn up to meet all the needs of students and teachers that are in trouble with students being in difficulty. So we know that this project that was shown actually makes us understand how rich maritime education can be. And we are going to talk about this with teachers that witnessed this. And now I think we can ask partners that have already presented their outputs. Maybe we can move to Ireland to ask how their three-year problem was carried out. This is something new in a way in the Erasmus Plus cooperation project that experienced some problems because of the pandemic. Here we are. So I don't know whether Tim Ford is there. Are you there? Maybe you could give us your feedback on your experience, the Atlantic Youth. He's in charge of sports at the Clare County Council.
And she will present on behalf of Clare County Council. Can you hear me?
Oui, oui, je vous entends très bien.
Yes, I can hear you. Okay, so maybe you can. So we can. We are waiting for your speech.
Siobhan will speak on behalf of Clare County Council.
Sorry, Francois, I can take that.
Ah, Siobhan, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for the presentations. They have been excellent. And it's a very different event to what we thought we would be having in May. But unfortunately, that's the impact of COVID across the whole of the world. I have to, in particular, thank our schools, Scovera and Ennis Diamond and Scariff Community College, for their continued commitment to this project in probably one of the most difficult, not probably, the most difficult year that principals will have put down in teaching in this country. The times that we live in are very different. But in fairness to the project, the learnings from the project have been of huge value to students and teachers and all of us involved in the project. We were very lucky to have had the experience of the transnational events and of the cross jurisdiction cooperation between parties. It's very valuable for our students to travel and to learn the different cultures that exist in different countries. The Atlantic Youth Project for Clare County Council has been of significant benefit for our students in learning all about the marine activities. And because Clare is a coastal county, and also because of the River Shannon on the east coast of Clare, near where the Scariff Community College sits. So in light of the time pressures that you're under, we'd just like to offer our, in relation to our inputs to the project, and I The intellectual outputs were in principle done by our four other partners, but our students and teachers and the staff fed in significantly to the project in terms of the translation piece and also inputting to the drafts of the intellectual outputs as they were presented. So again, I'd just like to thank Tim and his team for his commitment to the project and for the delivery of it. It has been of huge benefit to all of us, and as a local authority, it's a project that ordinarily we wouldn't have had the opportunity to get involved in. But I think it has shown the benefit of working together with our principals and the teaching staff and the students in the schools and with yourselves as a community to deliver, which I believe was a very, very valuable project for everybody. And I do hope that there's learnings from this and that there's continued output and cross-border cooperation in relation to future projects of this nature. And again, Francois, just from Clare County Council, in terms of your role as the coordinator, I want to thank you for all that you've done. It's been most beneficial and you've been most helpful, particularly in relation to some of us when we travelled with our lack of language. So again, thank you for everything.
Merci, Siobhan.
Thank you, team. Thank you, Siobhan. We really appreciated the cooperation with the Clare County Council because you took on a challenge that was very difficult, and we organized the first transnational event of the Atlantic Youth Project in the county, Clare County. That was the first time, and we had to dare a bit. We were successful, and this allowed us to launch a strong dynamics within the project. So I think that this partnership was really important and really strong, with all partners being very active, and that was an enriching experience. So now maybe one of the partners would like to add something before moving on to the next part of the meeting, that is the teacher's feedback. Is there anyone who would like to add something? Well, okay, so we can move on. We'll have some extra time at the end. If anyone would like to add something. So we had the chance to have 7 schools that were very present and active of the project. I would like to ask Professor Paolo Lima and Manuela Costa, the Cattedra Domena, a secondary school, to share their experience. And in particular, what we would like to know is what is the final feedback. As Portuguese teachers, what is the last word, let's say, the final word that you can share with us?
Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon, everyone. It's a pleasure to meet you again. We have prepared a short presentation that will answer your question, Francois. I'll try to share our screen with you now. Can you see it? Very well then. On top of everything that was already said this afternoon, we should underline the engagement / involvement of the entire community. we were able to engage children from the age of 6 and their grandparents. All of them played a key role throughout the project over the past 3 years. People with different backgrounds, physical disabilities, social behavior, economic struggles were never an obstacle, were always seen as an opportunity to foster a dialogue regarding maritime education. Here we have some numbers regarding the students that take part in this project. But as Julius said earlier today, we were able to involve the entire community, the broader community. We were faced with an initial obstacle. The selection of the students to take part in the transnational events. At the school level, we had around 80 students participating in the project, but only 25, 26 could attend the transnational events. So we had to rethink the selection of the students to go to the international events. But that challenge became an opportunity, because we wanted to keep all students motivated and engaged. And so the solution was to develop the Atlantic Youth Passport, which was useful for our school. We are still using it today. It's a way of engaging the students in all projects carried out at the school level. The students would get a stamp each time they would complete an activity. Each page corresponded to a country. And if a student would participate in an activity related with that country, they would get a stamp for that country. At the end, those that had more stamps, those would be the ones selected to take part in the transnational events. We have to revisit our ways of work internally in order to carry out this project. And these were our three priorities. The C that needs us, the C that amuses and educates us, and the C that protects us. The C as a provider. Now I would like to give the floor to Manuela to present you our journey over the past 3 years. Just some highlights, because we carried out many other initiatives, but most of you are already familiar with those initiatives. We're just going to share with you now, this afternoon, these key highlights, which can be a source of inspiration for you in your schools and at your communities. I'll give the floor now to Manuela. I'm sorry for the feedback. Hello, everyone. As Paulo said, we divided this topic in four categories. The C that need us. In this case, we visited a museum on the protection of the marine species and a museum on fishing activities. It was a very interesting visit to our students. We live very close to a river and very close to the sea. We also visited a gallery of biodiversity in order to raise the awareness of the students for the biodiversity and the relationship between the land and maritime ecosystems. We also prepared a fish tank that was taken care of by our students. The sea needs us throughout these 3 years. We monitor the dunes system at the Cabedelo beach. We carried out beach cleaning up activities several times over the past 3 years, picking up any kind of waste. We carry out a very small project, which is called The Ocean and Us. And the objective was to collect urban waste before it ended up at the beach or at the sea. As you can see, you have that all these big waste bags. So the collection was huge. Then another topic, which was the sea that provides food to us. We visited a sustainable production of different species of seaweeds that are used for food production and the production of cosmetic products. We also used storyteller events. The storytellers would count a story related with the sea. The sea is part and parcel of the Portuguese identity. It's the backbone of our culture, of our identity. We also visited the Gil Yange vessel. And we also created motifs with dyed salt to produce a carpet to religious processions in the city of Viana do Castelo. This is mainly used in our key public holiday called Nossa Senhora da Agonia. Here, during the visit to the Gil Yange vessel, we were able to see the waste which is collected in the sea. We decided to separate the waste and identify the origin of the different items. Some were coming from France, others from the UK. This is to show that the sea meets no borders. During the Halloween, we carried out a show which objective was to raise the awareness for the pollution of our seas. And then we had the carnival. And during the carnival, the main topic was, as I was saying, the protection of our seas and to fight the pollution. We had children from the primary school to the secondary school, and we involved also parents, teachers, and non-teaching staff. And of course that we also carried out nautical activities over the past 3 years, different types of sports. kayak, stand-up paddle, surfing, and so on and so forth. We had the opportunity to visit the former hospital vessel, Gilienge. We also carried out a project with the school Escola Azul. They challenged us to organize a school day, and we prepared several videos, all of them related to the sea. Another important aspect was a first aid training, which was provided to students. So that they can act in case of accident during any nautical activity. By providing them this training, they would be equipped to provide first aid. We would like to conclude by asking all the participants to give a big round of applause to all those that work very hard so that all schools from the different countries could take part in this outstanding project. Let's have a big round of applause, please.
Manuela, comme les six autres écoles.
Like the six other school, your school was very active. It was a true engine of our project with a teacher team that was very invested and children who were very interested in the project. And we were struck by the creativity of your team during the activities that we offered through the school, whether it be culture, the nautical sector, the marine jobs. You really explored the different jewels that were produced by the project, and your school produced many. So thank you very much. I will now speak about another school, and we might go back. Now we will go to Ayamonte, and Lorena Del Casteno and Joseph Raya Fernandez. I had a question to ask you, Lorena. And because you were pillars in the project and you were very active, very present, it was a pleasure to work with you in this project. I would like to ask, what is the summary of your experience with Atlantic Youth? Was it an experience new for Ayamonte? Hello, it's a pleasure to see
you.
Thank you very much. So when we started with Atlantic Youth in 2018, in our school, it was a revolution, and also for the whole city of Ayamonte. It was an international program in Ayamonte, and with the participation of students from other countries, this was something that was great. Everyone was so expectant. Not only us in the educational community, but also the whole city. The project was communicated through the radio, the social media. We had an opening act, and it was something so important for the schools, secondary schools, and the whole community of Ayamonte. So also from the management teams, well, they thought that the physical education teachers were the people that should be with the students in these projects. And then they decided that it was the second level of the secondary school education, that should be the students that should use this Atlantic Youth project. This second level in our city is very particular, and it's very heterogeneous. And most of the people in this second course, in this second level, which are 11 years old or 12 years old, many of them are at risk of leaving the school. Some of them, they are between 13 and 15 years old, and they have a lot of problems, social problems. And we thought that maybe this project should be something that could be motivating for them so that they could come back to the system, to the educational system. Also, many of our students thought that, or normally they don't even think about going abroad. Their family, their parents never went abroad, and maybe they weren't going to go abroad. So this idea of just boarding a plane, going abroad, sharing experiences with other teenagers from other places in the world, that was something that was very motivating for them. And regarding our centers, our schools, we didn't have a previous educational system. We did have other projects that had took into account the context, but with Atlantic Youth, we suddenly realized that it was very important to introduce maritime or marine education as part of our curriculum. So from this point on, we modified our educational project, and one of our goals was to work on maritime education. Also in Ayamonte, the culture, the nature, history, food, economy, sports, everything in our city is around the sea. We have a very important river ending in the sea, and that is with the borders with Portugal as well, and with the sea. In our center, we took more into account the context and the environment that our students are coming from. And in a personal level, and from the physical education department in the school, we valued or revalued the physical education in the natural environment. It was related to the salt or saline areas in the zone. And we also included other things, and we thought that it was very important to educate the students around their environment. There were students that participated in our project, and they have had more skills, and I would love to say that most of them were able to participate in this, but unfortunately not all of them participating in this. We planted the seed, but the flowers didn't bloom at the same time, that I would say that. So when we were doing the local actions, it was so good to see the students that in all the subjects were feeling bad or were misbehaving. Those days when we were going out to carry out the activities, they were feeling more able, more capable, and they were telling us that they were feeling as they knew more than their peers. And also I would like to mention all the professionals, all the teachers that developed this project. I would like to appreciate your work. During these 3 years, all of us, the participants, we were richer as people and as professionals, and in my case as a teacher. So thank you very much for your participation, and for being so warm, and for your contributions. Thank you very much.
Merci beaucoup, Lorena, pour ce témoignage.
Thank you very much, Lorena. It was quite incredible to work with the team of Ayalante, José María, Maxime, José Antonio, Rafael. We had very active partners. They were very creative. I want to thank you. I would like to say that this is just the beginning of a period of educational project, and I would like to thank the town for its participation. It was very important. José María, would you like to add something? Good afternoon.
Sentimiento que ha supuesto este proyecto para el centro, para
very important for the center. Well, some of them cannot be here now. But for our center, this project of Atlantic Youth has supposed to open borders, gain motivation to keep on working on an education project like this. As teachers, we are very proud to have contributed with our little work in this wonderful experience that took 3 years and expressing our interest for the ocean environment. Atlantic youth means before and after in their lives of students. They have known more and better possibilities that can be found in this environment. They have practiced different sports and activities that without the program, this would have been impossible. They have learned about the history, present, and future of their cities. Atlantic Youth has provided them with a great training that will allow them to be more ready and able in the future. They have learned that there's no barriers to contact people from other countries. Finally, to me, this project has allowed me to meet professionals of other countries, different ways of working, different ways of teaching, and also to, for my personal enrichment, with the places and aspects very important that I didn't know. In addition, I've been lucky enough to know people like Lorena and Jose Antonio that they make up an extraordinary human team. Their professionality, training, motivation, interest, knowledge, and way of acting are incredible. They have been fundamental pillars during these years. I hope they will keep on being it forever. I have known very deeply different people and created friendship links. All experiences and moments will be always in my heart. All experiences lived in these 3 wonderful years. I am very proud of having been part of this Atlantic Youth team.
Thank you very much, Jose Mario. That's a very nice testimony. And like many teachers, you were one of the pillars of this project. And it really gives us an appetite to continue to go further. And we think that at CIM Alto Minho, you will find solutions to continue this program. You have created many contacts with professionals. And I think that the town of CIM Alto Minho is supporting you. So congratulations. And the message that you have given regarding the opening towards other countries, towards Europe, and new experiences is very important. And an opportunity that Erasmus has given us. So now I would like to receive the presentation of Patrick Carouat of the Mesquat College. Patrick is the director for SECMA, for children who are very endearing but have enormous difficulties. And Patrick has lived 3 years of the project and has much to tell us regarding the advantages of the project on this young audience. Patrick, the floor is yours. Please unmute your microphone. Do you hear me? Atlantic Youth is a project that allowed us to think about what we were doing before and what we could improve to make progress to ensure that young people would learn and continue to learn. And we're looking into a sector that wouldn't attract them naturally, so to speak. So in Finistère, we have three pillars: agriculture, food, and sea. But the problem is that the sea is a neglected subject. We do not look at the professional trades behind it, etc. Young people of SEGPA, they are young people experiencing difficulties at school, and their learning is delayed. They are experiencing various difficulties, and they are children who are giving up. They can be dyslexic, hyperactive, etc. And what we try to do is to create an adapted teaching to those difficulties that students face. In terms of problems, first of all, I will talk about the difficulties faced in Atlantic youth. These children have problems regarding attention, concentration. They cannot spend time without an activity. They always need to be entertained. For example, when we visited the seaweed factory, we had to wait quite a long time. And this could, some people got a bit irritated. And at one point, we had to take them out of the group to try to calm them down, because they are pupils that you have to manage continuously. In terms of construction of learning, we concentrated on one thing that seemed paramount for our students: the fact that they needed to know how to swim. Why? Because all sports and nautical activities are within the reach of our pupils. So our pupils will not always go to the beach, will not always go windsurfing, kayaking, etc. And they don't have any culture about the sea. So we had to develop these things. So swimming, so when we talk about swimming, comparing it to other secondary providers, we doubled our swimming teaching compared to other schools, because we ensured that they would be at ease in the water, and then they can be able to practice nautical activities, and we also prepare them to activities in the sixth grade and seventh grade, and we will continue to do this. We will also worked in inclusion within the school, and that speaks a lot in terms of C-Camp, because we consolidated the team within the school. We ensured that they would be able to leave on a boat for around a week and be able to live together on Etoile des boats, to learn to live together. The pupils in year 6 and 7 visited companies and asked questions regarding trades that they didn't know before or wouldn't think about. We also chose to work with one activity, a theatre. that all the SEGPAs, so all the years in secondary school, work together to present to the rest of the college, of the school. And that was an activity that they undertook for a whole week, and they made three shows for the 800 pupils at school with a few parents, and they were very proud because they didn't think that they would be able to achieve this. And throughout this action, they presented a play based on The Tempest by Shakespeare, and it was really a very powerful moment. They also visited the city of fishing and also learned about the economy and the fact that Brittany is truly one of the main reasons, one of the main regions where there was a lot of jobs linked to the sea that could interest them. In French year four and three, at the end of year five in France, there are pupils who can't swim. And after this French year six and five, everyone knows how to swim, and we then offer swimming lessons where they can learn new things, and we ensure that they practice something that they wouldn't do naturally, because unfortunately often our pupils come from impoverished backgrounds. There, for example, I presented seven or eight actions over the course of a year, and we recreated this during the 3 years. Some of them will continue. But the interest of all this is that we carried out activities such as making in Bacamari, a coastal town. We had a project there. We created a meal with products from the sea. Patrick, can I ask you a question? Because we don't have much time. Regarding everything that the college did and was a very experience, and we followed Mesquat closely. After 3 years of project, is the relationship with these young people that was in existence with the sea previously, has that changed? Let's say that some young people today have joined clubs, kayak clubs. Some of my pupils, with their family, Sunday they went windsurfing. So all these activities linked to the sea, even if everyone does not participate, we tried to propose and suggest these activities that for some are pointing them towards activities that will lead them to a club every weekend. Yes, that's very interesting. So you mentioned, sorry, the sound is poor. Can you explain to everyone that the fact of practicing these activities, what does that bring about in terms of behavior for young people and attitudes towards others, open-mindedness, and many of the things that you mentioned? So it's interesting, the advantage of learning elsewhere. Sorry, this is inaudible. It allows us to give meaning to education, and that's important. They learnt from a different context. We created a link with adults with also amongst the group that was with them in the activities, and that's socially important. And we carried out some activities on this week of unity here in Moulin-Mer, and orders at a certain time have participated, and pupils asked if they could push them in the water. And as teachers, we ended up swimming with the pupils and laughing together, and that's something that's very powerful and unforgettable. Yes, because what you're saying is that for those pupils, schools can become attractive, teachers can become friendly. It allows us to change the context, the usual context, where they find themselves blocked and reluctant. Yes, totally. They can see the teacher in a different light. And they can work with them in a different way, because after all, regarding what you were saying earlier and the teacher who was killed, effectively, we have to work on these values and build a common future. And this is very important, to create a trust and action between young people and adults in order to ensure that teaching is not boring and everyone can find something that they like within. Thank you very much, Patrick. And it's also the link of these young people and their regions that they didn't know or explore until then. And if they can be attached to the region where they live, it's very important. So, I was wondering if you could come back about teachers.
That other teachers had to step in and teach, and then at the parents' meeting, etc., so they couldn't join. But we've worked really closely with Elston Community College over the past 3 years, and for those 3 years, we've delivered 8 local sessions where employers came in the classroom or hosted the students at their premises. All the sessions focused on different aspects of the maritime sector. Some sessions were about maritime pollution and the maritime environment. Some others were about boat building, marine engineering, water sports, etc. So we tried to have a varied program over the 3 years. And the last year was a team building activity on the water where the students did some kayaking activities and really enjoyed that. So the teacher from Elston Community College have shared some feedback for me to share with you all. So I'm just going to go through the notes. So they've said that overall the project really benefited the students in terms of gaining confidence and soft skills. The whole project benefited all the students in some way or another, and not just those who went on the overseas trip. The students were able to interact with students who they did not necessarily mix with, and From there, they learned to make new relationships away from their usual groupings. Those students as well who were from disadvantaged backgrounds or those less able had the chance to interact with their more able peers and get a sense of perspective and raise their aspirations. And the teachers said that that was made possible through the in-college and outside of college workshops that Cornwall Marine Network delivered. For the students that were more able, or the students with higher career aspirations, they were able to look at potential careers with a view of trying to keep some of our homegrown talents in Cornwall. In relation to the students who participated specifically in the trips overseas, so the trips to France and to Ireland, the students really bonded by shared experiences and they grew in confidence while they were away from their families. That's something that the teachers really noticed. And they also shared with us the fact that the ability to meet students from other countries was really impactful on the Cornish students because some of them had not traveled much. Some of them had not traveled outside of the UK or not even outside of Cornwall. And most of the students who participated in the transnational trips were from the most deprived areas in Cornwall. So learning to interact and overcome language barriers was really stimulating as well for the students. Seeing fellow students wanting to communicate in another language was really important because it makes students realize that we do live in a global working environment in which they will not be able to rely on English as the main language. The teachers also said that the projects really benefited the students in terms of making them realize the importance of the marine sector in Cornwall and the jobs that are linked to the marine sector. So the students were really surprised at how their interests could be well catered for in the marine sector. Students were able to interact with a range of different adults, from teachers who may not have taught them to the employers and those delivering the in-college sessions. So over the 3 years of the project, the students had the opportunity to see a range of different career choices and to experience interesting workshops promoting the marine sector. And being able to hear about the potential jobs which directly relate to the environment which the students live in gave really the students a feeling that they could do well in Cornwall rather than having to move away from their families. And on the other side, for those who aspired to leave Cornwall, they were able to see just how far a career in the marine sector could take them and give them a better understanding of the potential of working abroad. So all in all, the feedback was really, really positive and they were delighted to be involved in those 3 years.
Merci beaucoup, Aurélie. Et puis...
Thank you, Aurélie. You can say hello to the British professors, teachers, who were very active. So we are sorry that they're not here with us, but we hope that despite the Brexit, they will be able to work together.
I'll share the feedback, and they were indeed delighted to be part. So I'll really share that feedback. Thank you.
Merci. Et maintenant, nous allons...
And now we can move on to Ireland with the two college partners, Angela McManamara, Scariff Community College, and Josephine Donnellan of Scoil Menina and Estimon. So the floor is yours. But then we'll have some time for extra questions. So the floor is yours, ladies.
Josephine or Angela?
Josephine, Angela?
Good afternoon, Francois. Good afternoon, everyone. You're very welcome to the Wild Atlantic Way in County Clare. Thank you for very interesting presentations this afternoon. It was really lovely to connect with the Atlantic Youth organizers and also to connect with our friends in other Atlantic Youth schools. Our school is situated in the northwest of County Clare. It is a relatively small school. The Cliffs of Moher and the seaside village of Lahinch are nearby. And to our north, we have the Bourne area, which is a world-renowned area of ecological interest. Participating in the Atlantic Youth Project has been a very valuable, a very worthwhile experience for our students. The local program was a very positive collaboration between our school, Scariff Community College on the other side of County Clare, and our local authority, Clare County Council. The programme gave our students a really great opportunity to experience maritime sport, maritime industries, and maritime education. The transnational aspect of the project gave our students the opportunity to share experience of all these maritime opportunities with participants from our coastal neighbours in Spain, France, Portugal, and the UK. The transition year students, that's the fourth year secondary school students, were directly involved in the programme. But our entire school community, as well as the students' families and their local communities, benefited indirectly from our school's involvement in the Atlantic Youth Project. 90 students and 12 teachers participated directly in the project. First of all, as regards in-school education, over the 3 years, the class groups who were involved in the program undertook modules of maritime education. They participated in a Three for the Sea art project. This project explored the issue of pollution and the health of the environment, with particular reference to local beaches. The students undertook a beach cleanup, had a presentation from a local environmental activist, and completed ceramic and wall hanging art pieces to reflect their thoughts and feelings on the subject of the care of our coastal areas and beaches. Students from the class groups involved in the Atlantic Youth Project participated in our national young scientist competition with projects exploring the potential and efficacy of seaweed products as a base for health and beauty products. Through our collaboration with Clare County Council, students participated in a program of maritime sports: surfing, kayaking, and sailing. Many of the participants had not experienced these sports previously. Many of them developed an interest, particularly in surfing. And not only have they continued to enjoy the sport themselves, but they have also introduced their friends and families to surfing. And a number of participants of the project had become quite proficient and quite enthusiastic about the sport. Through this valuable collaboration with Clare County Council, our students were introduced also to maritime industries and career opportunities. And this was promoted through visits to local companies, for instance, seaweed harvesting and processing, tourism, maritime tourism, for example, considering a career as a ferry operator. The students experienced a wonderful trip to around the cliffs of Moher and to the Aran Islands. And they also had very worthwhile presentations from the Irish Whale and Dolphin Group and the National Aquarium. These were careers that the students probably would not have considered previous to the presentations. Students in our school now have a heightened awareness of the need to protect our maritime environment from pollution, and they now say they are much more likely to consider a career in a maritime industry. They also say they're more keenly aware of their personal responsibility regarding disposal of litter and waste. They report they have educated their families in this regard also. Students also tell us they are more alert to whale and dolphin sightings, and in future will report these sightings to the Irish Whale and Dolphin Group. The transnational event was a lifetime and very memorable opportunity for our students. It was very valuable for them to share activities and understanding of maritime culture with the participants in neighboring schools, in the Atlantic youth schools in other countries. And they were really proud to introduce our coastline and our county to the Atlantic youth participants in 2018 when you all visited Clare. The transnational event also promoted that sense of the importance of cooperation and friendship with other nationalities. And they really valued the links they made with friends in other European countries. They considered that really, really valuable. So sincere appreciation, Francois. Sincere appreciation to all of the organizers. We are very grateful to our hosts for the transnational events. Participation has been so worthwhile and a really wonderful opportunity for our students. And at a national level, at a county level, I have to say particular appreciation to Mr. Tim Ford and Clare County Council for including our school in the project and for the valuable opportunities provided to our students. To all involved, we know you worked really hard to make the Atlantic Youth Project really wonderful. Míle, míle buíochas. Thank you so much from the bottom of our hearts here in Scoilwidde in Ystaimon. We will always remember the activities, the visits to the industries, the transnational events. We will remember all of our Atlantic youth experience. And I'd like to say to all of you, you will always be very welcome to visit Scoilwidde in Ystaimon. And if you come, we will show you a great, great time. So thank you very much, Francois.
Merci beaucoup.
Thank you. We are really we are looking forward to coming to your region professors and teachers as well. Thank you for your experience, for sharing your experience that actually shows the impact of this project on students. Thank you. And now, Angela, the other college of the Clare County Council, of the Clare County.
You can hear me okay? So on behalf of all at Scariff Community College, I wish to sincerely thank all involved in Atlantic Youth for affording the school, our school, the opportunity to participate in this project. This project has proved to be tremendously worthwhile and significant in terms of educational impact in our school. With the invaluable support of Clare County Council, our teachers and our students were able to develop and follow a programme of learning which was inclusive and promoted cross-curricular engagement. While hosting the inaugural transnational event in Ennis, our students got to view our surroundings through another lens, or through different eyes, if you like. They welcomed students and teachers from the partner countries, and through playing host, gained a deep appreciation themselves for the beauty, richness, diversity, and potential of our own region. With the focus on the maritime, they met with a variety of successful business people who have made their living from the sea or the waterways, from seaweed harvesting to surf schools. And this has opened their minds to considering maritime careers and opportunities that they may not have previously thought of. They learned not only about what the ocean and our waterways can offer us, but also about what we can do as individuals or collectively to protect this priceless resource, and about our responsibility to do so and to be responsible citizens of this earth. Through this project, we forged new connections and found new friendships. I had the pleasure of travelling to Moulin Mer last year. It was a really wonderful week of learning, of getting to know each other, of students learning new skills, of experiencing other cultures and gaining more knowledge about our oceans and the life within. And thank you and well done to our hosts at Moulin Mer. It has also been a pleasure to work with Josephine and all at Skull Wirra and Ennis Diamond, and the connection between our schools has been forged. From Moulin Mer, we saw how, although we travelled there as separate schools, we pretty much instantly became a collective, les Irlandais, and we're very grateful for this new bond. This project has provided our students with wonderful learning experiences and an awareness of and appreciation for the sea and our waterways, especially important for the citizens of an island nation. So I wish to sincerely thank all at Erasmus Atlantic Youth. I thank all of you for your hard work, your guidance, and your commitment to providing such a worthwhile programme for our young people. And a special word of thanks to Clare County Council, especially to Tim Ford and Siobhan McNulty. I'm so very grateful to you both for affording our school the opportunity to be involved in this project. Without your faith in us and your support, we would not have been able to provide such a programme for our students. So, Mila Buyakis Illa, many thanks to all of you. So.
Merci beaucoup.
Thank you, Angela. What you witnessed is very interesting. The impact at a young level that as they discovered this ocean world, we all discovered that your island is surrounded by water, basically. So we know that you're really involved in this. And we really appreciated the possibility to work with the Clare County Council. That was great. We all hope that all this work that was done in the different schools and with the different partners, will experience a follow-up. So we hope that we'll keep working on this project. So it will not just be 3 years of sea experiences, but we'll have the possibility, because we are looking forward to it. So we hope we'll be able to keep working together. Maybe we'll move to the next step now. We have Raquel Costa here with us from the General Directorate of Maritime Policies from Portugal, and is in charge of an important project, Escola Azul. This involves different blue schools in Portugal. And we know that through the Atlantic Youth Project, we had the possibility to get in contact with all the blue schools and Raquel. And this gave us the idea to us and to all the partner schools. So this gave us the idea to start a project for the Atlantic Sea. So Raquel, the floor is yours. And I thank you for participating in this conference. I'm going to speak French to answer to your words. Thank you. I'm very happy to be here to share this end of project with you. And now I'll move to Portuguese.
CIM Alto Minho, convite.
Thank you for the invitation to be here today. I would like to greet all the participants. And most of all, to say that it's a pleasure to be here. I was also present at one of your gatherings, your initiatives, and it was great to see how you worked in such an enriching manner. And this makes me think that Erasmus Plus is a fantastic program. It allows us to work in a way that brings countries together, different educational contexts, different cultures and social backgrounds, pupils facing difficulties, and you showed amazing things that can be done just with willpower. And that is wonderful. I truly hope that you don't stop. I know this is a three-year project, but from what I have seen, this is just the start. You're just exploring, and I think it can continue for many years to come. You showed, for example, that you all worked not just on ocean and maritime literacy, and I will show the international context of that, but you also worked on cross-cutting skills, principles, and values, and that is amazing and doesn't happen quite often. And so I do think you all did a great job. I also wanted to tell you that I love listening to the teachers, the enthusiasm with which they present it, but you see that they hold the project very dear to them, and that is wonderful. It's the best way to talk about things, to really feel them, and it really shows. And from what I've listened, what I would like to share, an idea that I had, is maybe it would be interesting to invite at least a pupil from each country. It's also important to give a voice to the pupils and to know their experience firsthand. It would be good. Of course, that the teachers know what happens, but but I'm, well, it's my side. Since I wasn't a part of the project, I think that listening to the pupils might be interesting. And they have such a different but rich perspective that is so good for all of us. It's just an idea. And now maybe I would like to share a very short presentation. Let's see if I can do it. Can you see it? Can you see the presentation, François? Thank you. So the presentation, it's just a bit of context. It has to do with everything that you said today. It's just three facts. We're all aware of them, but the sea, the oceans are very important for our lives, and we also have a gigantic impact on oceans. For example, here we see that 40% of our diet comes from the ocean, and I know that you know this. Just to get to a point, more than 50% of the oxygen that we breathe is produced by the ocean, and unfortunately, in 2025 is estimated that we will have this amount of waste in the ocean. 1 ton of plastic for every 3 tons. And so that's why the community is trying to find a solution, all the communities. And I have here a few words that I think that characterize basically have to do with everything that you've said today and everything that we can do so that everyone understands that the ocean is very important for our lives, even for people that do not live near the coast. And that the things that we do on our, in our daily lives have an impact. And these words that I have here, words, expressions that you use directly or indirectly, understanding, to have an open mind, an open heart, to be inclusive, to engage people and to act. For me, these are words and expressions that really reflect how we can boost ocean literacy. And also to share with you, we are all part of the solution. And it's a bit different than teaching others about the ocean. It's not exactly that. The idea and our idea, what I've been seeing and considering, is that good projects are inclusive, like yours. And from the pupil to a person in a community selling fish, the teacher, all of these people are part of a solution of trying to improve oceans for everyone. How can we start with you and with projects like this? And it's like you talked about. And it has to do with also what we do in Portugal. The creation of a network of schools that are the blue schools, we call them. And we try to every day get our community, our communities, to act towards transforming the ocean into what we need for the future. This is a bit of the international framework, and to show you that what you've been doing for these 3 years has an international framework. It's published by the United Nations. And basically, all of these topics were addressed. I can share this presentation with you if you want, or the bibliographic references that are used here for the framework. This image here is an adaptation of mine, and it also includes the UNESCO approaches and the different principles. It's a merger, because the initial ocean literacy movement starting in the United States aimed at including just maritime sciences in school curricula. But it's not just about science, ocean literacy, it's about many other things, as you showed today. And UNESCO. UNESCO also addresses that. And something else that is used is the Sustainable Development Goals. And there are a few that focus specifically on oceans and water. And you touched on many of these and many of these issues. Regarding the Blue School, the concept that we created in Portugal is similar to what you've been doing for these past 3 years, so I'm not going to waste much time here. Because you really, checked all the boxes of a Portuguese Blue School. The criteria that we use for our schools, you worked on all of them. And you are an excellent example through you, your motivation, what you were able to achieve. You're on the right track. Right now in Portugal, we have almost 250 schools working. As you've worked, we were able to bring in families, communities, municipalities, and other partners, around 100 partners at the moment. They're working with schools. At international level, I would like to put forward a challenge. Don't stop. Blue schools ended up disseminating. There is a coalition now in Europe. We were kind of pioneers, but there is a coalition responsible for blue schools at European level. It's still at its early stages, but one of my challenges would be for you to apply to this European network, because it will allow to continue, even if there isn't a specific project or Erasmus Plus, to have participating together in schools and projects that have affinity. Another initiative that I think is relevant and might allow you to continue is the United Nations Decade of Ocean Science for Sustainable Development. And through this decade, there will be many cross-cutting projects. And one of the objectives of this decade is to promote ocean literacy. So starting next year until 2030, there will certainly be financing and funding opportunities to establish partnerships so that we can all continue working on ocean literacy and maritime education. another initiative that we don't know if it's going to be approved or not, but it's in the pipeline. It's just to share with you a project that is in the pipeline and we're waiting for approval. It's the Atlantic Ocean Research. There is a platform that requested the submission of anchor projects. For many months, I participated as a member of this work group, and we proposed the creation of an Atlantic network of blue schools. Now, we are waiting for the approval. It will be approved or not by the leaders. And if it is approved, it will open up the possibility of setting up a network with all of the schools that participated here in this Erasmus Plus, because they are Atlantic schools. But as I said, it's still in the pipeline and we don't know if it's going to be approved or not. I don't know if I have time or no, but I would like to show you a video that we produced here with the Blue Schools of Portugal. And it shows that even with the lockdown and with the pandemic, we are able to work in network. And we produced a video that I think is wonderful and I would like to share with you. I hope you enjoyed the video. It's a short version of what we were able to do with schools throughout the entire lockdown. And what pupils and parents shared with us from their homes. They shared over 2,000 initiatives, and we compiled. It was quite difficult in a short video, but then we shared, just to say that even difficult times like the ones we've been experiencing, it is possible to do very interesting and fun things that really try to light us up. Thank you.
Merci beaucoup, Raquel.
Thank you very much, Raquel. It really shows us what we can do during confinement, and in every country we've missed the sea a lot. It's a true love song to the ocean. And what I remember from what I note from what you said is that another Atlantic project with blue schools that wasn't retained by Erasmus Plus, but we're not giving up, because the new partners and schools that were very motivated towards that direction, I now think that the time is right to make progress, and you are going to be with us. We will work together, and this is very reassuring. And as you demonstrated, whether it be within the United Nations or UNESCO, maritime education at school, ocean literacy, and the blue schools are really a theme of our times. And we are in the current affairs by saying that we want to progress in that direction with all willing schools. I don't know whether I can say a few things, Francois. I wanted to share this with the others, to tell them what was happening with UNESCO and Atlantic Youth Project. It's very recent. This is a new initiative, and it will include countries throughout the Atlantic region. And I believe that it will give focus to the candidates that we already had for Erasmus Plus, because in the Atlantic region there's South Africa, Brazil, Argentina, Canada, United States, and we also need European candidates. So it would really be a shame if we don't need to be part of a big network that will begin next year. That's why. Thank you for this message that motivates us even more. And I think that Paola will conclude, and at the end we will see a video of the Anis events that Tinfo will play to conclude the conference. So Paola, and I would like to thank the CIM Alto Minho. Thank you to the organizers of the conference, Francisco. I believe that it's a technical success. It's incredible. And Paola, the floor is yours.
Well, I would like to take this opportunity to thank you, all of you, from the bottom of my heart, for your engagement and for the outstanding presentations.
Merci, Paola.
Thank you. Tim, can you now play the video, please, that will remind us of good memories for all us teachers and partners, this video on Ennis. Francisco, is that okay?
Yes,
inaudible, pardon.
I'm very much unaccustomed to staying quiet, but I'm going to let this video speak 1,000 words for us. Goodbye, everybody, and thank you for today.
Executive. Have you the sound? No?
It comes in a moment, Francois. Oh.
Merci beaucoup, Tim, pour cette vidéo.
Thank you very much, Tim, for this video. First transnational event, the second one was incredible to Moulamer, and the third is quite exceptional, but a success too. So now we will place all the results of the project online, all the outcomes. We will work out how to do that with CIM, and I hope that Francisco, we will be able to place this conference online and keep a copy for those who would like to watch this again. And I think it's now time for conclusion. So thank you very much for having participated to this conference with five countries that are member of the Atlantic Youth Project. And we will continue to work in the same direction in the future. And thanks to you and thanks to all your efforts in the last 3 years. Thank you and goodbye.